Good morning, and it is not a good morning in New York City.
I just thought, oh my gosh, why are people flying planes into buildings?
A major disaster, a plane crash into the World Trade Center.
I'm going to die, aren't I?
No. Say
I'm going to die.
Live, say your prayers.
We were afraid for how many other people were going to perish on that day. That was hard to bear.
The devastation of 9/11 tore apart families. Fathers and sons. Sisters and brothers. Husbands and wives. Survivors were trapped in more than 1.5 million tons of debris from the towers.
There was death and madness there in that smoke.
Some were reunited.
I have to find them. Whatever it takes, I got to find them.
Others were not.
Let's make sure we bring them home.
But after the towers fell,
people are going to be in this void, just waiting to be rescued.
They stopped at nothing to find their loved ones.
They're trapped. We can't let these people die.
The task was so large. We're never going to get there.
At 9:55 a.m., the upper floors of both towers of the World Trade Center were burning out of control. Hundreds of firefighters were already at the scene. Among them, John Morabito was evacuating civilians in the North Tower lobby.
There is people coming down the stairs, they're crying. Some of them are actually burned. Some of them are bleeding from the debris that hit them.
Then, John heard a sound he will never forget.
It was like someone's dropping some heavy equipment, and it was coming frequently. Boom! Boom!
It was the sound of bodies falling to the pavement.
People were jumping from the floors above, and now we realized that the situation upstairs was very grim.
With tragedy unfolding around him, John had another pressing concern. He believed that somewhere amidst the chaos was his younger brother, Michael. Two blocks south, evacuating 500 students from their building overlooked by the Twin Towers, was high school principal Ada Dolch.
I tell them, you've got to get into Battery Park. Go find your teacher, stay with your teacher.
As she guided her students, Ada had another reason to be concerned. Her younger sister Wendy was at work at the very top of the North Tower.
I remember simply saying, you know, God, you got to take care of Wendy, because I got to take care of these kids.
Then, the South Tower began to buckle.
We just start hearing this awful, loud, crackling sound.
I feel a tremendous rush of air. I feel heat. I feel ash. And it's just... I get picked up off the floor, and I'm flying in the air. And I'm screaming at the top of my lungs, God, please save me. I don't want to die.
I turned around and I see this cloud.
God,
It was so strong, that wind that came behind you. Felt like it was cutting your neck.
Inside the lobby of the still-standing North Tower.
I'm praying, please help me, please help me.
I'm in pitch-black darkness. I can hear people screaming in the darkness.
Firefighter John Morabito tried to find an exit.
Now I'm starting to panic because I can't find my way out.
With the South Tower down, John realized this one could collapse at any second.
Situation that started bad just gets worse and worse and worse. The North Tower is still standing, but the World Trade Center South Tower has collapsed.
In suburban New Jersey, watching the horror unfold live on TV was a pregnant Louise Buzzelli.
It was just so bizarre and so unreal.
Her husband, Pasquale, was working on the 64th floor of the North Tower.
Obviously, the two buildings were almost identical, and if that one fell, then, you know, chances are his was going to fall next.
Back in the North Tower lobby, John Morabito scrambled to find a way out. He noticed a patch of light.
That's a window. To me, sign from God. Here's a light. Follow the light. You're going to be okay.
He made his way out of the building and onto the street. Then, the North Tower began to fall.
Is that the second building of the World Trade Center going down?
Yes, that is the second. That is the second tower. That is the second tower.
I'm screaming to everyone, you run, everybody run. And everybody's yelling, and we start running. A nuclear winter. There's ash everywhere. We can't see anything, and it's total silence.
This has been an absolutely unbelievable morning. The news is breaking almost faster than we can get it to you, and right now we are...
I watched my husband die right in front of my eyes, and there was nothing I could do to stop any of that.
With the World Trade Center destroyed, all that remained was a 16-acre zone of destruction, known instantly as Ground Zero.
There's a smell of burning in the air and burning wires, and vehicles are on fire. And everybody was just trying to figure out what happened.
At the center of Ground Zero was the pile. Here, more than 1.5 million tons of broken steel beams and twisted girders stood up to 7 stories high.
It was all gray, and there was smoke coming out of it. It looked like a living, breathing entity.
Firefighters were now on the front line of a new battle to save potentially hundreds of people buried alive.
That was my first thought. If people made it to the lower levels, they can't get out. They're going to be running out of air, but they're still alive. And our responsibility is saving lives, and that's what we want to do.
The smoking ruins of Ground Zero were the last hope for anyone searching for a loved one.
The odds are stacked against us, and we're trying to do the best that we could. And we know we have people that are going to be in serious trouble, and we have to get to those people.
For John, the search was personal. One of the firefighters caught in the chaos was his younger brother, and John assumed the worst.
I'm sick to my stomach, and I'm thinking, I'm not going to be able to go home. You know, he's my younger brother. I love him so much. We're such a tight-knit family. How am I going to go home and face him? We're never going to be the same. This is going to tear us apart. It's going to tear the whole family apart.
Take it away. me to demonstrate.
A brand new series of Mythbusters.
What can you say?
Monday at 9, only on Discovery and Discovery HD.
Insure with somebody who cares about you as much as you care about your car. Direct Line looks after careful drivers with up to 65% no-claims discount, and they'll preserve your no-claims discount if your car is vandalised.
Visit directline.com.
Got a quid for the meter?
He's not a payphone.
At Machine Mart, you can buy... washers, generators, tool chest, air compressors, wood stoves, water pumps, log splitters, workwear, space heaters, jump starters, trolley jacks, storage racks, welders, power tools, engine cranes, hand tools, table saws, mitre saws, jigsaws, chainsaws. Machine Mart have a huge range of tools and machinery on display in their 56 superstores nationwide. Top brands at low prices and friendly expert advice. The new Machine Mart catalogue is out now. Pick up in store, online or call.
Reinventing the vacuum cleaner has been a personal obsession. It began with Cyclane technology. For me, the fundamental answer to loss of suction. Then came our ball, a radical alternative to fixed wheels. Our mission is simple. Solve the obvious problems, whatever it takes.
I'm going back to uni and I need a powerful laptop for work and play. And this stylish Sony laptop for only £549 is just that. And has £200 off. It's powered by Vision Technology from AMD. Plus with a 4GB memory and a 500GB hard drive, I'm powering through the work. And when my girlfriend wants to go online, this Sony netbook comes in really handy. It's only £299. Plus, trade in your old laptop and you'll save an extra £50 off any computer across the store. Our world is graduating with honours. Whatever your world, PC world.
Never know how much I love you. Never know how much I care.
You know he's back on the quest, looking for the most exciting new taste in Sheba pouches. New Sheba Desire. Lovingly prepared with real fillets of delicious chicken and fish. Go on, satisfy the longing for Sheba Desire.
They can face the fury of the Bering Sea. But can they face the death of the captain? Deadliest Catch, Tuesday at 10 on Discovery and Discovery HD.
Trade Center is no more. What was there this morning when we woke up is now gone.
The collapse of the Twin Towers killed thousands. But miraculously, some survived, trapped in the center known as the Pile. 1.5 million tons of steel and pulverized concrete. A challenging obstacle in the search for survivors.
Couldn't see more than halfway down the block. Still that cloud was hanging in the air.
Retired firefighter Lee Ayelpi was among those who raced to the pile to join the rescue operation.
You could see walking wounded coming at you. Fires burning in the smoke.
For Lee, the urgent search for survivors was all that mattered. He was searching for his eldest son, firefighter Jonathan Ayelpi.
My Jonathan, firstborn boy, of course. So special, any dad. 29 years old, married with two little boys. Totally dedicated to life, totally dedicated to his kids.
Lee was on the outskirts of Ground Zero when he heard a familiar yet ominous sound.
It was a very eerie kind of quiet, except for on the back of our air tanks that we carry, if you stand motionless for 30 seconds, the tone goes off. It's just a... And what it does is it signals to me that a fireman is down, unconscious, and he needs help.
Lee knew that one of the emergency signals could have been coming from his son.
There were so many going off. It was disturbing.
There was another firefighter on the force also getting first-hand experience of Ground Zero. Lee's youngest son, Brendan.
And 4 or 5 inches of dust everywhere you went. Passing burning cars and things blown over and broken. You never expect to be just passing that like it's nothing. A couple guys were discussing how many firemen are going to be dead. Was it the first second or the whole second alarm units?
Brendan knew his older brother was one of those missing firefighters.
I was trying to calculate in my head, all right, when did my brother go? Is he going to be within one of those units? Or did he get here late?
But amidst all the chaos and unanswered questions, there was no doubt that there were survivors somewhere in the pile.
All of us felt confident that we're going to find a spot where we're going to lift something and the people are going to be in this void, just waiting to be rescued. We got to do this quick.
Lee was on West Street. Here, debris was strewn across an entire city block, cutting off access to the pile. For rescuers, getting to the site was a seemingly impossible task. There was no plan and few resources. They needed to do something.
As I turned, there's 3 guys there, construction workers. One guy said, I know where there's backhoes. I said, get them. He said, I'm going to have to hotwire them, which means he's going to steal them. I looked at him, I said, hotwire them.
It is a scene just not to be believed. The smoke still billowing.
Millions watched the destruction of the World Trade Center on live TV, including Joanne Hatton in Ridgefield, New Jersey.
I remember going to school to pick up my children, and everybody was asking me, you know, is Lenny there? Is Lenny there? And they said, yes, he's there.
Joanne's husband, Lenny, an FBI agent, was last seen helping with rescue efforts inside the North Tower.
This is the worst day in the history of New York City, and we don't even have the death toll in yet.
I was watching, and my kids were watching it, and all I could think of was the devastation. I told my kids that we would not be hearing from Daddy for quite a while, at least a week or so.
The rescue workers at Ground Zero realized that hundreds of people were trapped alive in voids beneath the collapsed towers, and time was working against them.
Now they're trapped in an area where smoke is beginning to fill and there's no fresh air, and well, we can't let these people die. They speak about the golden hour. If you can get to someone within an hour, there's a better chance that they'll survive.
With the clock ticking, John Morabito desperately searched for his younger brother, Michael, also a firefighter.
I'm thinking to myself, I gotta find them. Whatever it takes, I gotta find them.
John held on to the hope that if his brother had survived the collapses, he still had a chance. But when John saw an official list of missing firefighters, his worst fear was confirmed.
I look at the list and my brother's name is on it. So now I'm really starting to panic.
On the opposite side of Ground Zero, the same feeling of panic gripped another firefighter.
I made a decision in my mind that John's probably dead.
Still alive, it was John's brother, Michael. He, too, believed his brother was dead.
John's dead, he's gone, and I have to do my job. And if I think about John...
Whilst firefighters at Ground Zero faced an enormous task to get to survivors, they also faced another challenge. Several large office buildings were on fire around the site. Under normal circumstances, any one of those fires would have been a major event, calling for hundreds of personnel.
I did more work in those 2 hours than I've done in my entire career in the fire department. We put out more fires and went through more stuff than I've ever done in my life. I have a ton of energy, and I was beat. I was spent.
The Port Authority has closed down the Lincoln and Holland tunnels and the George Washington Bridge.
In all the chaos, officials feared that more terror attacks on Lower Manhattan were coming. High school principal Ada Dolch gathered her students and teachers and told them to go home.
I said, okay, you live in Queens, you start walking in that direction. I live in Brooklyn, I'm gonna cross the bridge. Whoever wants to go to Brooklyn, follow me.
All the while, Ada knew she was leaving someone behind. Her younger sister, Wendy, a broker's assistant with trading firm Cantor Fitzgerald, who worked at the top of the North Tower. No one had heard from Wendy, but Ada remained hopeful. It wasn't the first time her sister's office building had been attacked.
I remembered that back in 93, when we were frantically looking for my sister after that bombing, and then finding out that she had been shopping all day, I kept saying, oh, she must be shopping.
John Morabito had been working at Ground Zero for more than 2 hours. He struggled with the thought of his brother's death. Exhausted, he finally took a break.
I'm dried out, I'm parched, my eyes are itching because of the dust and the smoke. And I happen to look up, and on West Street, I see a fire hydrant.
It was then he spotted a familiar face.
I'm drinking, and I look up, and my brother walks in front of me. I'm like, this is amazing. How is this even possible? I jump up, I call out, Mike, Mike.
And it was like, oh my God, you're alive.
I got him in my arms, and I'm, you know, I love you so much, and I could finally call home and tell them we're both all right. We both made it.
When I found him, it lifted the weight of the world off my shoulders. So I said, all right, John. I said, you're good? You're safe? He said, yeah. I said, all right. I have to go back in there. There's other people in there.
Michael and another firefighter started climbing the unforgiving terrain of the pile.
We were all over the place, shimmying across pieces of pipe, holding on to stuff. It definitely was a hard trek getting through that pile. It was like mountain climbing.
John was amazed at his own good fortune, surrounded by all the destruction.
I walked away from the trade center with a cut on my finger, no broken bones, no major devastation whatsoever to my body. Psychologically, that's a different story.
At Ground Zero, another family of firefighters was also desperate for a reunion.
And I saw guys I know from Jonathan's house, 288, there was a few of them. So I felt a sigh of relief.
But when Lee ILP caught their attention, his hopes for finding his son Jonathan alive quickly faded.
They just looked at me and put their heads down, and I knew.
Lee continued with his mission.
You have to stay focused. If you break down, then you're not on track. Okay, let's keep going. Let's just keep putting one foot in front of the other.
Then, trapped within the smoldering pile.
Okay, good for it. More power, farewell, bees and boy.
A survivor opened his eyes.
Face the death of the captain. Deadliest Catch, Tuesday at 10 on Discovery and Discovery HD.
I want to live in a world where a new day means a new dawn.
Where I can communicate in new ways.
I want to live in a world where I can dream new dreams.
New dreams!
A new chance to meet new friends
and be given new hope.
I'd rather live in a world where I can just get a new phone every year with a simple 12-month contract.
Oh.
Thanks very much.
Get a new phone every year from Tesco Mobile. Ever little helps.
Peter has a 90 HP diesel engine that consumes 3.8 litres per 100 kilometres. Paul has a 1.6 petrol car emitting 158 grams of CO2 per kilometre. They both drive 75 miles at 66 miles per hour. Who out of Peter and Paul consumes less and therefore pollutes less? You have 4 hours.
With Citroën, it's simple. The economical new Citroën C3 VT from only 8,990 with £2,000 welcome reward deducted and now with 3 years free servicing.
Yeah, Churchill, could I really save up to £216 when I buy car insurance?
Oh, yes.
And you'll give me a free guaranteed hire car if I make a claim?
Oh, yes.
Yeah, right. Tell me you want a tug-of-war competition at the weekend.
Oh, yes.
See how much you could save with Churchill. Call our UK call centres or go online.
At Bath Store, we know bathrooms inside out. And now there's up to 50% off. So visit us in-store or shop online. Sale now on.
At British Gas, we're committed to answering your call in 60 seconds. If we can't, we'll offer to call you back. Letting you get on with your day.
Hello, it's British Gas returning your call.
Look after your world with British Gas.
Is your toothpaste giving you complete protection? If not, the problems stack up fast. And the main cause? Bacteria. That's why you need Colgate Total. Only Colgate Total is clinically proven to provide 12-hour antibacterial protection to help protect your mouth from all of these problems. Colgate Total, 12-hour complete protection.
Kellogg's Crunchy Nut Clusters, ludicrously tasty.
Been looking for a second one. Something a bit different. Perhaps just for the weekends, you know.
Improve your chances in the property market. Visit zoopla.co.uk.
Why am I still alive?
The explosive truth about the ultimate heroine is about to be revealed. Use intuitive Wii remote controls to explore the stunning science fiction environments from two perspectives. Metroid Other M, only on Wii.
Time. Finding the right home insurance deal takes time. Have you really got the best price? because Direct Line guarantee to beat the price of your current home insurer. Just a single call or click could save you time and money. Remember, Direct Line aren't on price comparison sites, so to beat the price of your current home insurer, call us now or visit directline.com. Well done, boys.
Thanks, but we're not used to bit parts.
What do you want, a red carpet?
Yes, please.
I'm here to show you Uncle Ben's oil-in-the-bag rice. It's so easy to cook. You just drop it into boiling water, wait for 10 minutes, and voila. Perfect rice every time.
Uncle Ben's boil-in-the-bag rice is easy to cook and perfect every time. And remember, when you don't have a geezer at home, you can always use an ordinary saucepan.
Sleep deprivation, disorientation, all for the right to fight for your nation. Relentless mind games, living on your wits. The only thing that saves you is knowing when to quit.
It's hard to see a grown man just totally losing.
Imagine being tortured, feeling half dead, but the fight you're really losing is in your own head.
What is wrong with you? You are all weak!
The Special Forces job interview, 2 weeks in hell. A one-off exclusive coming soon on Discovery and Discovery HD.
At Ground Zero, rescuers raced against the clock to pull survivors from the collapsed towers.
It was all moving and shifting. There was pockets of fire everywhere. Everything was smoldering.
With hundreds of emergency workers dead, there was chaos on the ground. Firefighters searched the area for survivors without a defined plan.
We really didn't even know where we were going. There was nothing recognizable, just steel. It was just a mess.
Then from nowhere. Fire department radios received signals. They'd located the first survivors.
The information we've been looking for all morning is the extent of the casualties from this horrific attack.
40 kilometers away, family members gathered at Louise and Pasquale Buzzelli's home in Rivervale, New Jersey. Louise was waiting for news of her husband, who was in the North Tower when it collapsed. Pasquale's mother was inconsolable.
She just grabbed hold of my stomach, and she just was just crying and said, this baby's got to have a father. This baby's got to have a father, you know? That was probably the worst thing for her to see, was her only son's wife and this big belly, and, you know, he's gone.
Okay, James, one more time. What is your location?
At Ground Zero. Radio messages came from within the pile. Trapped emergency workers had made contact with rescuers.
Tower 1, stay well in. There's also an injured civilian chief on the first floor.
The survivors were inside Stairwell B, the only part of the North Tower that was still intact. Firefighter Michael Morabito immediately went there.
I just was like, I gotta help these people.
The stairwell was a miraculous haven for this small group of survivors.
It kind of looked like they ripped the whole building apart and just left this little bit of stairwell. They were like scissor stairs.
Michael believed even more people might have been trapped there. He and another firefighter climbed through the unstable remains of the stairwell in search of survivors.
We have no ropes, we have no security, and we're by ourselves. But if both of us go down, we're on our own, and now all of a sudden we become victims.
Michael's instincts were correct. When the men looked up, they made a startling discovery.
And he looked at me, he goes, and he just shook his head, and he turned and goes, holy guys, he goes, we gotta survive here.
The man Michael found was Pasquale Buzzelli. Somehow, he rode the tower down as it collapsed.
I just sat up and I said, I'm actually alive, I can't believe it.
He was sat on a pile of rubble next to stairwell B, several meters above the 14 other survivors.
He was just sitting there in the daylight like he was sitting in a park.
But there was a problem. Pasquale was separated from the firefighters by a deep gap in the pile. And Michael and his team didn't know how long they had to get him out. They feared he could have sustained dangerous internal injuries in the collapse.
So at this time now we're making small talk with him just to keep him calm, because we have to get him across this void.
They realized there was only one way to get Pasquale down quickly and safely. They created a rope harness and put it around him.
I just leaned forward and fell off the edge, and the rope cradle grabbed me.
I took him, we swung him right across. The whole time we're talking to him. You're gonna go home to your pregnant wife. You're gonna have a happy life. Don't worry about it.
I just wanted out of there. I was thinking about my wife.
In Rivervale, New Jersey, Louise Buzzelli anxiously awaited any news about her husband.
I didn't want to talk to anyone unless it was him, and I was walking by the kitchen. The phone was ringing at that moment. I said, oh, let me just answer this. So I picked up the phone, you know, and I said, hello.
I said, Louise, it's me.
I said, oh, my God, Pasquale. And I said, where are you? You know, oh, my God, are you okay?
I said, I don't know how. I said, but I'm alive. She was, you know, when you come home, come home. You know, when you come home, I said, all right. I said, I'll, you know, do my best.
Back at Ground Zero, only 15 people had been pulled out alive from the pile. Rescue efforts were painfully slow, but reinforcements arrived, including Port Authority Police Lieutenant Bill Keegan.
We knew it when it was standing, and we know it now that it's fallen.
Years of working at the World Trade Center had given Bill a good understanding of its layout. He knew that even now, there were many routes in.
We have all different ways into this site, from underneath or from other directions in the city subways, walking through the tunnels.
But his initial confidence was shaken when he met a colleague.
He began to tell me some of the names of the people who were some of my best friends that were gone. And I said, maybe they're at the hospital, maybe they're here, and him looking at me like, you don't understand yet. They didn't make it. And I realized then, and right at that moment, that this was different, that this was going to be a very dangerous job.
And the most difficult search and rescue mission in New York's history was about to get even tougher. As he worked at the pile, firefighter Brendan Ielpi anxiously watched Building 7. Damaged by debris from the collapse of the towers, it was dangerously unstable.
That whole building was on fire the whole morning. Everybody was still working, looking up, working, looking up, working. You knew it was only a matter of time.
Just north of where the Twin Towers stood, Building 7 had been burning out of control for more than 6 hours. Finally, it fell.
And it wasn't until somebody said, run, that I realized that this huge cloud was coming towards me. I ducked in behind a car, and then a whole plume of smoke hit me.
For Bill Keegan, this was just the beginning.
It was just as if the pile was still angry. There was still death and madness there in that smoke.
Demonstrate. brand new series of Mythbusters.
What can you say?
Monday at 9, only on Discovery and Discovery HD.
Noble team, take that cruiser out now.
Coming soon on Xbox 360.
Insure with somebody who cares about you as much as you care about your car. Direct Line looks after careful drivers with up to 65% no-claims discount, and they'll preserve your no-claims discount if your car is vandalised.
Visit directline.com.
Got a quid for the meter?
He's not a payphone.
Off home insurance if I haven't claimed in 5 years. Is that right, Churchy?
Oh, yes.
Which means I could save up to £147.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, right. He told me his house sitting for David Bellamy next week.
And on Friday, Water the Rhododendron, the Zinnian Pepper Tree and the Mammalia.
Yes.
See ya.
For 50% off home insurance, count on Churchill. Just call or go online.
Sai, T-Mobile, Gaming Night In, Thursday the 15th, our place.
Who would you invite? Get everything you need for the perfect T-Mobile Night In with five things for £5 from Blockbuster.
Reinventing the vacuum cleaner has been a personal obsession. It began with Cyclane technology. For me, the fundamental answer to loss of suction. Then came our ball, a radical alternative to fixed wheels. Our mission is simple. Solve the obvious problems, whatever it takes.
I'm going back to uni and I need a powerful laptop for work and play. And this stylish Sony laptop for only £549 is just that. And has £200 off. It's powered by Vision Technology from AMD. Plus, with a 4GB memory and a 500GB hard drive, I'm powering through the work. And when my girlfriend wants to go online, this Sony netbook comes in really handy. It's only £299. Plus, trade in your old laptop and you'll save an extra £50 off any computer across the store. Our world is graduating with honours. Whatever your world, PC world.
Never know how much I love you. Never know how much I care.
You know he's back on the quest. Looking for the most exciting new taste in Sheba pouches. New Sheba Desire. Lovingly prepared with real fillets of delicious chicken and fish. Go on, satisfy the longing for Sheba Desire.
Sleep deprivation, disorientation, all for the right to fight for your nation. Relentless mind games, living on your wits. The only thing that saves you is knowing when to quit.
It's hard to see a grown man just totally lose it.
Imagine being tortured, feeling half dead, but the fight you're really losing is in your own head.
What is wrong with you? You are all weak!
The Special Forces job interview, 2 weeks in hell. A one-off exclusive coming soon on Discovery and Discovery HD.
As dusk fell on Ground Zero, Only 15 survivors had so far been found. To get to any remaining survivors, rescuers had to crawl through webs of twisted steel and dig into heavily compacted concrete.
You get maybe one of the tunnel guys to get in there, we might be able to find somebody.
It was a mammoth effort that called for huge amounts of manpower. Hundreds of emergency workers had been killed in the attacks. But people from across the country dropped everything to go to Ground Zero and lend a hand.
I grabbed my stuff, loaded the SUV, and headed up the Jersey Turnpike.
Volunteer firefighter Lou Angeli raced nearly 200 kilometers from his home in Delaware to Lower Manhattan.
I was asking the chief, you know, where could we get tools? And he said, tools? He said, here are your tools. And we were just digging by hand at that point.
Heavy machinery was the easiest method, but it couldn't be used. It might have crushed anyone still alive within the pile. So they quickly devised a solution.
Someone came up with the idea of using 5-gallon buckets. Well, all of a sudden, 5-gallon buckets started showing up.
For Lou and the others, the work was physically and mentally exhausting. But they were driven by one thing, the determination to find any remaining survivors.
I just wanted to keep on digging. I can remember my hands hurting, my arms hurting. We felt we were really doing something that was important.
By sunrise on September the 12th, families searching for loved ones had grown desperate. Rumors circulated that victims were really out wandering the city and that they were just too dazed to make their way home. Ada Dulge held onto one last hope that her sister Wendy, who worked in the North Tower, might have been amongst them.
The amnesia thing is the thing you keep hanging on to. Maybe she has amnesia. Maybe she's in hospital somewhere. Maybe she's hiding somewhere, you know, in trauma.
In one last effort to find Wendy, Ada posted missing flyers, hoping to gather any information on her sister's whereabouts.
I think that was one of the saddest moments. You really couldn't walk anywhere without seeing just banners and banners of missing people.
At Ground Zero, rescue efforts became more organized, even as the chances of survival became more remote.
If you find a way to get down to B2, go for it. The key to this thing is...
And a new and heartbreaking problem demanded attention. People began receiving voicemails from loved ones who were in the towers. Believing the messages were from survivors trapped under the pile, they reached out to Bill Keegan for help.
There's a young girl who calls and says that her father called her. And she said that he's okay, but he's trapped. And he needs help. And you could hear it in her voice. She wants us to do whatever.
Keegan and his search team scoured the site, but they found no trace of the girl's father. He soon discovered why. Technology was to blame.
A lot of these people's phone calls had hit the satellite at the same exact time, and what it did was it saturated them. They were sending those messages out, but it was 24, 36, 48 hours later from when the phone calls were made.
Delayed by 2 days, they were voicemails from those who had died. At Ground Zero, the search for the living slowly turned into the recovery of the dead. Firefighter Brendan Ielpi had been at Ground Zero since 9/11, searching for his older brother, Jonathan.
We were just getting frustrated. Where the hell could he be? You know, where are you?
Instead of finding his brother, Brendan found the remains of others.
I remember we worked on this one person for a while. It was only an arm, but it was a man's hand with his wedding ring. And we were so proud. His wife is going to have some type of closure because we found at least something.
But for the ILPs and other families, Ground Zero was no longer the only place remains could be located. The FBI was now using a former landfill site on Staten Island, known eerily as Fresh Kills. Debris from Ground Zero was shipped there and searched a second time. Agent Jerry Fornino helped to run the operation.
We did a job of, by hand, raking, sifting human remains, personal items. It was always our duty that we would give something to any family who lost somebody, that they would stay connected to that family member.
Now, for the ILPs, finding some remains of Jonathan was their last hope.
In reality, it was a needle in the haystack, but you had to do something. Something had to be done.
The mission was, no matter what condition he's in, let's make sure we bring him home.
One week after the attacks, hope of finding any more survivors at Ground Zero had faded. Now the mission turned to recovery of the human remains, scattered throughout the site. The pile took a heavy toll on workers. But in the search for his brother, Brendan Ielpe remained focused on one thing.
After a while, I think you just became numb to the body parts, to the smell and to all that. Down at the pile, you had one goal, to find my brother.
I can remember my grandson, the oldest was 10, running up to me and saying, "Beepot, did you find Dad? Daddy." I said, no, not yet. And he did that every day. Did you find him today? Did you find him? And then after, a week or so, he wouldn't ask anymore.
For 89 days, the ILPs kept searching for Jonathan's remains. They'd found nothing. But on December the 8th, there was a vital clue.
They had found a buddy of his who was working with him that day in the South Tower. Found him in a stairwell and said, "Well, if he's here, the other guy's got to be here. We got to be close."
Exactly 3 months after 9/11, Jonathan Ielpe's body was found.
I remember going behind one of the buildings, just pumping my fists. We finally got you. We found you. You could hide, but we got you, buddy. And I say, how could that be a great day? It doesn't make sense. But it was. It was probably one of the greatest days, unfortunately, I think I'll ever have.
In New York City, the company that lost a man at a fire is the company that carries that man out. So in this case, Brendan, myself, and some of the men who were there that night were able to carry Jonathan out of the site and bring him home.
Ada Dolch learned of her sister Wendy's fate. She was one of 658 Cantor Fitzgerald employees killed in the attacks. Ada's family submitted DNA samples to the authorities in the hope that Wendy's remains could be identified.
How do you begin to bring some closure to this? My mother was a total wreck. We just didn't know what was right, what's not right.
The day after Christmas 2001, they finally got an answer in a call from the coroner's office.
I always say it was no coincidence that the first identifying remain of Wendy were two molars. And I would say that's because she had a great big smile on her face. So everyone could see her teeth all the time. So there was no surprise that we found her teeth. I don't know, it just silly brings a little comfort.
The ILPs and Ada Dolch were lucky. Remains for nearly half of all the World Trade Center victims were never identified, leaving their families with nothing.
I knew he was dead. I didn't know what to tell my kids.
I was just hoping that they would find him.
Joanne Hatton was among those who never received remains.
I wish there would be something. I know there won't be.
Her husband, FBI agent Lenny Hatton, was killed in the collapse of the North Tower. But Fresh Kills, the Staten Island landfill site, provided some closure. It was here that a melted fragment of Lenny's 9mm service gun was found.
I just remember holding it. There were so many emotions at that time. I really wanted to keep it because it was a part of him. I wanted to keep it so that my children would have a piece of history that day. But at the same time, I had nothing to bury so that I could make a place for the kids to go to, that he would be there. I buried it.
Thousands of workers spent 8.5 months searching for the dead at Ground Zero. Officers from the fire and police departments, Port Authority, as well as construction workers, and legions of volunteers. The last piece of steel was removed from Ground Zero, marking the end of the recovery and cleanup effort. The official end of the mission was called in by Port Authority Lieutenant Bill Keegan.
Last piece of steel is heading eastbound on Canal Street towards Kennedy Airport. 198, which means we're done. Thank you, Central.
After the towers fell, tens of thousands of lives were changed in an instant. Everyone affected asked the same question. Now what?
Thankfully, with God's grace, I not only have my brother, but, you know, proud that he's still a firefighter and that I'm still doing it.
For some, it was about embracing their new lives. 2 months after his miraculous survival, Pasquale Buzzelli and his wife Louise welcome their first daughter. Her name is Hope.
It was just amazing just to, you know, watch her being born. I was so lucky that I was there to actually see it happen.
For those affected by 9/11, it was about finding ways to move on.
It's taken me many years to realize you can't recreate a life that you had. And I'm okay with that now.
You can't let this consume you. So thank God the good Lord made us strong of mind. But get on, you better believe we're getting on. We gotta focus on what is the important thing. And the important thing is, what's tomorrow?